Hey, welcome back to Given Chances Farm. Today we're just out here cleaning the goat stall. So, we've got one load already. With us using sawdust from a local company that makes things out of red oak. And so they asked us if we wanted the sawdust, so they fill the 55 gallon metal drums full of it, and then we go and pick it up whenever they have a few of them available. But it was definitely time to clean the goat stall, so what we did was we put the sawdust down first, and then with it not being warm out, we were able to spray the sawdust down with water. So to help with the dust problem, we took one bale of straw, and we just added it to their stall on top of that, so it would keep the dust down but still be able to work as kind of like a litter box for a cat. So it helps hold that moisture when they urinate, but then the straw on top of it doesn't allow that dust when it's not wet to make it all nice and dusty for the goats to breathe. So
here for stall cleanings, we tend to take turns loading the bucket full of what needs to be cleaned in the stall. So I loaded the first bucket up, Tony's gonna load the second bucket up, and then I'll take over after that. And what we do with our stall cleanings is we stick them in the chicken run for them to scratch through and turn it all into compost. And then, you know, of course, when they scratch through it, the bugs come up to help break down some of the stuff too, which then gives the chickens some food to scratch for. So they're doing the natural turning for us instead of us having to do it. So that helps for that part of it. Also, in some of the stuff, there's loose hay that the goats have knocked down on the ground. The chickens will scratch and eat that too. And then possibly whatever, maybe the seeds from the grass or from the hay that's knocked down onto the ground, maybe it'll reseed itself and possibly have grass come time this springtime.
As you can see, right down there is where Tony dumped the first pile, and you can see all the chickens mostly had gone down there to scratch through that. The remainder of them are still down here scratching through the scratch green that I dumped for them.
So earlier we were able to get the goat stall cleaned out. Was able to use the tractor and not tear up the yard very much. But tonight's a different story since it warmed up enough. It's just that top layer is kind of soupy right now. So we went from dealing with that good hard freeze, solid ground to mud again. So. And it'll be that way off and on because we've got rain coming in on Sunday. There's like a 50% chance of rain, and it's supposed to be like almost 60, I think. So it'll be pretty interesting. So, but with the warmer temps, the cows haven't been going through the hay as much either. So it's kind of a trade-off, I guess. Just something we we learn to deal with around here. So it's, you know, gets colder, they go through the feed a little bit more so they can generate heat. Warms up, gets muddy, they slow down a little bit, but they're even slowed down on their water intake also, because that week that it was below zero and we had the snow on the ground, we were topping off their tank twice a day. And today they drank it down to about half a tank, so we're topping it off right now. Yesterday we didn't put but 10 gallons in it, so but with everything melting, all the snow, they were actually drinking out of some puddles out there. I seen them drinking that, which to each his own, I guess. I wouldn't drink out of it because I'm sure there's some urine involved in that that they're drinking, but I guess they know better than I do. They wouldn't drink it if it wasn't right, supposedly, but I don't know. I'm not doing it, I guess.
I guess if we had to.
Right. I mean, you don't have to. There was clean water source right here, but I mean, it'd be a different story, I guess, if you had to, but
they were just being lazy and didn't want to walk back up to the water.
Right.
The clean water. They'd just rather stand out there and drink nasty.
But, yeah. So, but everybody's doing good. We're starting to make that push now towards the warmer weather so that we can start rinsing calves and getting prepped for 4-H a little bit more. And then we got the garden seeds. She's got them on the calendar as to when we can start some of the seeds inside. So since now that we got all of the equipment that we for the seed trays and the heat mats.
So. Yeah, the ones that I had was supposedly on back order. I got another box later on in the day with those no-hole tray bottoms.
Yeah.
So they all came in that same day, even though the first package slip said they were on back order. So I was expecting, you know, a couple weeks before I got the other package, but they were there, which was, I was happy.
Yep, so we'll see how it goes. Like I said, it's just been a couple slower days because with the temperature changes and I've had to work. I took on some overtime last weekend, so that kind of that was the reason we didn't have our YouTube live last weekend, was I ended up having to go in for overtime. So
and then some of the other things we got coming up is we'll have to build some pig huts.
Yep.
When we get our pigs, so each we'll be getting a boar and a set not a sow. She won't be a sow until
she'll be a gilt.
Until she has a litter, but
yeah.
So we'll get, like, I don't know exactly if they're gonna be like piglet size or if they'll be a little older piglets, but a breeding pair. So we'll have to get each of them a pig hut built, and then we got chicks coming in March, supposedly, as long as the
postal service
will deliver them,
right?
And that will be our meat birds. And then come May we'll have
two sets of
laying flocks.
The girls bought their own laying flock this year, so as of right now the plan is the two A-frame chicken tractors that we used last year for the meat birds, I'm actually going to allow the girls to use one of them for their laying flock up to the point of right before they get ready to lay. And then when it comes close to that age where they'll start laying, we'll actually transition them back into the barn. and put them into one of our stalls that we have set up for when we did chicks back then. So we've got netting up in there so none of the no critters can go up in the hayloft and come down through into that stall. So we'll make sure we got all that tightened up again and make sure none of it come loose and everything will be secure in there. And then I'll build them some roosts. That way they'll have some roosts, and then we'll get them a couple nesting boxes put in there too.
For the winter time.
For the winter time. That way it's in here and it's close to the non-freeze hydrant for water.
And there's outlets for
power so that we can use the heated base water like we do with our laying flock. So, and then Brittany and I's laying flock, we're getting red stars from Murray McMurray Hatchery, which is what their version of the Isobrowns basically are. We'll use the other A-frame tractor for them long enough to get them close to the laying so they can be out on pasture until it's time to lay, and then we'll transition them in. And then for the meat birds this go around, I plan on building a chicken tractor similar to the Joel Salatin plans. His are, if I remember right, I think his are 10 by 12, but I'm gonna go with maybe an 8 by 8 or 8 by 10, depending. I'll look into that when I get there. But my thought is I don't wanna go any wider than 8 foot on that style of chicken tractor because for one reason, Brittany and I don't plan on staying at this property forever. At some point we plan on moving to a bigger property. So if I keep that tractor down to 8 foot wide, then I know I can load it on a trailer and get it out of here and transport it to the next place. If I go to a 10 by 12, that limits me to either having to take it apart to move it or leave it behind. So, and I don't plan on putting that much effort into something to build it to leave it behind. So, but we'll see how it goes though. Cause like I said, I got a lot of projects to get caught up on with all the other work going on. Plus we've got farmers markets and all that to take care of also. So
4-H weigh-ins. Yeah. And
so it'll get busy here soon, so
then it'll be time to get into the bee boxes and start working. Yep. Then to make sure they're all there,
start working bees, and then once hot chocolate decides to kid, then there'll be milking twice a day, so things will move. What do you got to say?
Speaking of forage, we also need to get back on working the cows.
Yep, I know we do.
And start working tulip just in case I want to bring it.
Yep. So, yep, we'll get to it. Like I say, it's just we're taking one day at a time right now while it's cold. And we'll pick back up and hit it a little harder because, like I say, worst case, when you guys are on spring break, we'll be able to
work more.
Work quite a bit then because the weather will hopefully be warmer by then that we can do some rinsing and
yeah,
grooming and show all that stuff. So, but hope you guys enjoy our videos. We appreciate you guys spending time with us. Don't forget to like the video, share it on social media with all your family and friends. And if you're not already subscribed to our channel, hit that subscribe button and then the notification bell beside it to be notified of all of our videos. And we'll see you tomorrow. Bye.
Bye.